Undeniable, part four. We've been looking at the book by Douglas Sachs called Undeniable, subtitled How Biology Confirms Our Intuition That Life is Designed. And it's published by Harper & Collins in New York. And I have it on good authority that Amazon is having trouble getting the book to its customers, apparently because maybe, I don't know, they don't have enough stock or something. The electronic version, of course, is fairly easy to get. Anyway, there's the cover of the book. I got mine from Barnes & Noble for what it's worth. The core thesis of the book, as given by the jacket and as condensed by me, is that Douglas Sachs argues that the key to understanding our origin is the design intuition. The innate belief held by all humans that tasks we would need knowledge to accomplish can only be accomplished by someone who has that knowledge. For the ingenious task of inventing life, this knower can only be God. There is science that proves our design intuition is valid, and everyday experience can empower ordinary people to defend their design intuition. Living creatures are brilliantly conceived, utterly beyond the reach of accident. Our design intuition turns out to be correct. I'm going to quote from chapter one because it'll set the stage for the two chapters we'll be discussing. The next section of the book, chapters 6 through 9, will be a journey through the important aspects of common science. We did chapter 6 last week. Chapter 7 will be a common science refutation of the idea that natural selection explains how life forms came to exist in its countless remarkable forms. With natural selection off the table, chapter 8 will be an exploration of searching, showing that the many inventions needed for new life forms to evolve would have had to be found accidentally. And chapter 9 will then finish the section by showing why invention can't actually happen that way. That will be next week. The intuition that Crick wanted us to suppress, the design intuition, will end up being confirmed instead. So we begin with chapter 7, Waiting for Wonders. All attempts to explain how Earth came to be teeming with life must face the challenges of explaining extraordinary things. Ordinary physical causes seem adequate for explaining things that aren't task-oriented, things like atoms and stars and tornadoes. But our design intuition tells us that those causes can't explain the things we're calling busy holes, things like spiders and pool robots. Many scientists tell us otherwise, that ultimately everything is rooted in ordinary physical processes. These processes, they say, turn primordial soup into simple life, and simple life into simple animals, and simple animals into complex animals, some of whom make robots. If these scientists are right, extraordinary things don't really require extraordinary causes at all. This doesn't sit well with our design intuition, though. When we see working things that came about only by bringing many parts together in the right way, we find it impossible not to ascribe these inventions to purposeful action. And this pits our intuition against the evolutionary account. As our rejection of oracle soup showed, people differ not in whether they have the design intuition, but in whether they have exempted evolution from it. It's an important point. We all agree that a spider's web is the product of the spider's spinning instinct. The point in dispute is whether anyone intended for spiders to have that instinct or the body parts that enabled it to be used. If no one meant for spiders to spin, then spiders were invented by accident, making our design intuition deceptive. If someone did, then spiders were deliberately invented, making the evolutionary account deceptive. The way forward is to recognize that whatever value we place on the design intuition, we can certainly reason without it. Without rejecting intuition, we can learn instead on observation and calculation to decide whether we should expect a universe like ours to produce busy holes like spiders. The important question, then, is whether evolutionary theory is more in touch with our observations than our design intuition is. Is it? What fact did Darwin cite, or set of facts, that should, contrary to our intuition, make us expect things like sponges to be converted into things like orcas? What cause did he identify that has the power to make such extraordinary transformations so easy they happened a million times over in different ways? What could possibly tame such frightening improbabilities? The standard answer, even today, is natural selection, the tendency of more fit organisms to have more offspring. No one disputes this tendency, but can it really work these wonders? Robotic football fans, and a thought experiment will help us point to the answer. The one I have in mind has to do with football, of all things. Now, as everyone who's been to a professional football game knows, football crowds are loud. This is true in the United States, where footballs are oblong, and equally true in the rest of the world, where they're round. The Seattle Seahawks, in one game, had a measured noise inside the stadium of 137.6 decibels in 2013. That's noisy. Because football crowds are characteristically loud, then, might something with absolutely no understanding be able to find its way to a football game just by seeking loudness? I'm thinking of a noise-seeking robot. The robot has a directional microphone, and then after determining where the sound is coming from, it swims or crawls a short distance in the direction of the loudest measured sound, after which it stops and repeats the measurement and keeps going like that. The question is, what would have to happen for a robot of this kind to find its way to a roaring football stadium? Being dropped within earshot of the crowd's roar would be helpful. Even then, all kinds of things could go wrong. Competing sounds, like that of traffic on the streets, could interfere. The football crowd would probably generate much more noise than the traffic, but because sound falls off with distance, nearby traffic may register as louder than distant cheering. But suppose the drop point is entirely random, anywhere on Earth, with equal likelihood. In this case, the odds of success would be very slim indeed. Even when we take all the world's football stadiums into account, the Earth is so large in comparison with the regions within earshot of stadiums that there's little chance of our robot hearing even the faintest sound of a football crowd. Our poor robot would probably end up on a shoreline somewhere, enticed by the sound of crashing waves. We can get a more accurate assessment by looking at some numbers. If we assume there are about 2,000 major football stadiums in the world, each of which can be heard up to about a kilometer away, about two-thirds of a mile, then all of these within earshot areas amount to about 6,000 square kilometers, about 2,000 square miles. This is a meager 1/1% of the Earth's 500 million square kilometers of surface, which means the probability of our robot landing at a spot where a football crowd could be heard at all, if the timing is right, is a mere 1 in 100,000. Nevertheless, the robot's movements might bring it within earshot of a stadium eventually. Success is unlikely in the short term, but if we suppose our robot runs on solar power and is built to last, the odds should increase with time. Our expectation, then, is that repeated changes of circumstances will eventually put the robot within earshot of a football stadium. It may take years or decades or even centuries, but success must come in the end if the experiment continues long enough. There's something odd about this version of success, though. We started by asking whether the ability to seek noise might enable a robot to find a football stadium, and now we're invoking something other than noise, seeking to achieve success. This other factor is repetition. But if open-ended waiting is really an option, just how significant was the homing ability in the first place? After all, even something completely passive, like a styrofoam packing peanut, might make its way into a football stadium if we wait long enough. The connection to evolution. That same question of significance impinges on our discussion of evolution, which motivated the thought experiment in the first place. In fact, there are strong similarities between our robot and the evolution of a species, the main one being that natural selection acts very much like homing. Figure 7.2, which we'll see in a minute, shows what one of these changes might look like if we observed a species long enough to watch it happen. The process is nothing more than a gradual replacement of the most common genetic type, unmarked beetles in this case, caused by the presence in the population of a more fit type, in this particular case, double dot beetles. So you start out with a double dot beetle, and as it multiplies, it gradually spreads through the population, and pretty soon it has replaced the old non-marked beetles. Another similarity between our robot and the kind of genetic movement we're interested in is that for both, we have a clear understanding of success. We aren't asking whether natural selection causes just any changes. Instead, we're focusing on changes of the most noteworthy kind. We want to pinpoint anything in the evolutionary mechanism that might have the astonishing inventive power that Darwin and his followers have attributed to evolution. You know, things like amazing insight like that, sight like that of an eagle, or perhaps amazing ultrasonic hearing like that of a bat or a dolphin. To that end, the most important thing we learned from our robot is that the mere ability to home in on signal sources isn't what brings success. Instead, success occurs when the right kind of source happens to be close enough to outcompete any other sources. We saw this when we recognized how unproductive homing was unless the noise being followed happened to be from a nearby stadium. If the analogy to evolution holds, we should expect something similar for the homing caused by natural selection. As figure 7.3 shows, the situation is indeed similar. Like the robot represented in the upper half of the figure, the species steps towards the weaker of the two signals. I'm not showing figure 7.3, actually. The species steps towards the weaker of the two signal sources shown. In both cases, this is because the weaker source is closer and therefore more strongly sensed. The difference is that the robot receives sound straight from the close source, but the species must make do with much less definitive information. For our purposes, the crucial thing to get is that a new functional feature, an invention, produces no fitness signal at all until at least one individual in the species already has the invention, which means natural selection itself can't invent. So by the time selection begins to favor an invention, something other than selection has already invented it. This is one of these common science gems to be treasured, an obvious realization that gains revolutionary status for no other reason than a long tradition of ignoring it. Let this soak in for a moment. Despite all the grand claims, everything from the popular plea of Richard Dawkins and the Brian Watchmaker to the technical pitch of Graham Bell's selection, the mechanism of evolution, the very logic of natural selection assures us that the power of invention resides elsewhere. And because evolutionists have never agreed on what this elsewhere is, the gaping hole that has always existed in the middle of evolutionary theory is still there. The response to this gem from the defenders of Darwin's theory is that selection didn't produce eyes or brains or lungs all at once. Long before it worked upon complex organs like these, it was refining the many simpler things that paved the way for these greater things to appear. Each of the simpler things was beneficial for its own reason, we are told, so selection was able to work even though the grand functions didn't yet exist. Although this response continues to put selection forward as the hero of the story, again, something else has to be doing all the remarkable work of invention. Selection can cause a species to take genetic steps, but without any way of directing those steps, movement of that kind wouldn't go anywhere. To reach an interesting destination requires not just steps, but coordinated steps, helped along by nicely arranged stepping stones. I'm skipping over a little bit. Odds beaten or bypassed? We'll soon see why accidental invention must be highly improbable. In the meantime, if we provisionally accept this on the basis of our intuitions, we're prompted to wonder how an explanation of life can stand in the light of these improbabilities, not having overlooked them, but having properly dealt with them. There seem to be only two possibilities. Either an explanation beats the improbabilities, that is, it counters them with something equally potent, or it bypasses the improbabilities, that is, it renders them irrelevant. As you may have noticed, the improbabilities we're discussing are easily bypassed by following our design intuition. Explanations of life that credit the invention of living things to a knower avoid the burden of improbability altogether. As for beating the improbabilities, the tactic we resorted to with our robot turns out to be the only tactic. That is, the only way to beat improbabilities is to have such an abundance of opportunities for the unlikely outcome to happen that its occurrence is no longer unlikely. Another serving of Oracle soup will help us to see this. Supposing the chef insisted that the instructions were formed by nothing more than the process of boiling and cooling the soup, what could conceivably satisfy you that he or she is telling the truth? I hope you wouldn't fall for an authoritarian approach. Imagine a team of physicists all committed to materialism. Would you be persuaded if they gave you a series of technical lectures claiming that the physical causes that wrote the genetic instructions in primordial soup did their work in alphabet soup? Surely not. To stand your ground in the face of that kind of intellectual intimidation, you need a simple, unassailable, common sense argument, and that's exactly what you have. No amount of technical mumbo-jumbo can change the fact that it's extremely improbable for accidental causes to do the work of insight. If physicists attribute the instructions in the alphabet soup to correlative entrainment, whatever that means, your first question should be, did this correlative entrainment receive any assistance from someone who understood the instructions, or was it a completely unguided physical process? And if the answer is that it was unguided, your next question should be, of all the possible outcomes an unguided process might have produced, how was this correlative entrainment, whatever it is, so fortunate as to achieve such a special outcome? One that looks for all the world as though it was guided. There is no credible answer. Insight is absolutely unique, without rival among the mindless causes to which materialists limit themselves, and as we will see later, not reducible to these causes either. Sound waves are different from water waves, but they share some properties because they're both waves. Parallels for insight, on the other hand, are non-existent. Again, skipping over, we can imagine being surprised anyway. Continuing our thought experiment, supposing that after you expressed your skepticism to the chef, and this is on our Oracle soup, he or she leads you through the swinging doors, whereupon you discover that what you thought was a kitchen is really a logistics center, the mission control for a massive soup boiling operation involving 100 million square feet of kitchen space scattered over six continents. And what they really did was they found one in South Africa and they froze it and they brought it in and then unfroze it so that you could see the Oracle soup. Here the point is that accidental invention would have to leverage repetition to beat the unfavorable odds of extraordinary coincidence. With respect to this invention of living things, then, a commitment to materialism is a commitment to accidental explanation, and a commitment to accidental explanation is a commitment to coincidence, and a commitment to coincidence is a commitment to the power of repetition. These things all stand or fall together. Real selection, good, bad, and ugly. To round out this chapter, I want to describe three case studies from the laboratory, we'll only go through the first one, that bear out the conclusion we've drawn about selection, that it's an aimless wanderer incapable of inventing. The modernist view isn't entirely negative. Selection does one thing reasonably well. In fact, having failed as an inventor, it has managed to prove itself as a fiddler. I once constructed a mutant enzyme that proved to be a fiddler's dream, beta-lactamase. After six rounds of mutation and selection, using increasingly stringent selection with each round, we found ourselves with an amazingly well-repaired enzyme. By the way, beta-lactamase tears apart penicillin, for what it's worth. In fact, the 500-fold improvement accomplished by the natural fiddler even surpassed the performance of the highly proficient natural enzyme I had beaten up. So yes, it can do a very good job with appropriate selection. However, in order to make its improvement, selection had to be given a gene that encodes a working beta-lactamase enzyme, which is no small thing. Skipping over where he talks about if you don't have the structure of the enzyme, even having some vague activity won't be selected for. There are more embarrassing examples. Selection can home in on the wrong source, even when the signal from the right source is detectable from the outset, and worse still, it can burn all bridges to the right sources in its slavish pursuit of the wrong source. This ugly scenario is equivalent to the robot being lured to its demise by the sound of an approaching bus just outside a football stadium. A collaborative project between scientists at Biologic Institute and the University of Wisconsin at Superior demonstrated this by examining the evolutionary fate of bacteria carrying a faulty version of a gene that encodes one of several enzymes needed to make tryptophan, one of the 20 amino acids used to make protein. The faulty gene carried single DNA base mutations at two locations. That's all. It's got to get two mutations right to get back to the original enzyme, each of which resulted in a wrong amino acid being incorporated into the enzyme. Both of these errors had severe functional consequences. One of them was disruptive enough to eliminate the function on its own, and the other caused substantial but not total impairment. As a result, bacteria carrying this broken gene were incapable of growing unless they were given enough tryptophan to survive. Now, you would think selection ought to have been able to repair this faulty gene as long as the bacteria were given enough tryptophan to grow and reproduce slowly. After all, stepping stones to full restoration, one gene mutation at a time, seem to have been carefully laid out. An initial mutation could have corrected the debilitating error, bringing the benefit of partially restored tryptophan production. That advantage should have then led to an abundance of cells with a partially repaired gene, which only have one mutation, and would have set the stage for the second mutation to correct the remaining error. Once this happened, the benefit of normal tryptophan production would have enabled the restored cells to flourish. However, not only did selection fail to restore the faulty gene, but it also led to irreversible inactivation of that gene. Moreover, it did this by doing exactly what selection does well, homing in on the most accessible source of higher fitness. Because it costs a cell something in materials and energy to construct protein molecules by decoding the sequence instructions on a gene, faulty genes are a burden to cells that carry them. Silencing these genes so they can't be processed at all removes this metabolic burden. The take-home from homing. Having given natural selection due consideration, we conclude that it lacks the power to invent. This isn't to say that selection is completely useless, only that it's useless as an inventor. In the end, we're left with two candidates for the role of life's inventor, one fitting our design intuition and the other challenging it. If insight turns out to be the only plausible cause of invention, our intuition will have been confirmed. Alternatively, if repetition, presumably on a scale far beyond the familiar, turns out to have the power to invent, our intuition will have been overturned. In order to decide between these alternatives, we need to consider the limits of repetition. Our noise-seeking robot was able to find a stadium only by wandering around aimlessly long enough to come within earshot, and we can expect something similar for evolution. That is, to stumble upon an invention, a species would have to wander aimlessly long enough for this to be a likely outcome. But is this possible? To find out, we'll think about the limitations of blind searches in the next chapter. And now we're in chapter 8. In chapter 6, we saw that our design intuition explains why we perceive busy holes to be products of intent and how living things epitomize that category. In chapter 7, we asked whether anything has the power to defy the odds and our intuition by inventing life without intent. Despite all the fuss surrounding it, natural selection lacks this power. Noting the parallels between our noise-seeking robot's aimless wandering and the similarly aimless genetic wandering of a species, we realize that repetition is the only factor that can conceivably offset the improbability of stumbling upon biological inventions by accident. Having associated this improbability with coincidence, we still need to connect it to the earlier subjects of busy holes and the universal design intuition. We'll do this in chapters 9 and 10. In preparation for that, we now turn to the question of whether some things might be so hard to find by aimless wandering that we should consider their accidental discovery to be impossible. If this turns out to be true, we'll want to know whether biological inventions are among those unfindable things. If they are, we'll know Darwin was wrong. Hunting for eggs. The familiar way to find something is to search for it, which in our experience is always a goal-directed effort. Here we'll use the word search differently. For our purposes, it will help to call any process that could potentially find something a search, whether or not there was a goal. In this broad sense of the word, our noise-seeking robot in the previous chapter searched for a football stadium, and evolving species search for helpful biological inventions. We'll call searches like these egg hunt searches because they have several important characteristics in common with Easter egg hunts. The first of these is there is definitely something to be found, something special to be found, whether or not the searcher is aware of it. The existence of recognizable treasure of some kind makes a successful outcome both possible and unambiguous. Not all searches are like that. The person combing a beach with a metal detector or sorting through a coffee can full of old coins hopes that there's something valuable to be found, but there's no guarantee that such a thing exists. The second characteristic of egg hunt searches is that they occur within a well-defined space. That is, they all start with a treasure somewhere out there, where the there refers to a definite bounded region. The smaller regions this region is, the easier the search will be, but there are no limits. The region could be so large that the search is effectively impossible. If a watch left on a train in London fails to show up at the Lost and Found office by the next day, we know it's within a day's journey from London, but the portion of the globe that meets this condition is far too big to search. The watch is gone. The final characteristic of egg hunt searches is that they always proceed without assistance. The only way to get the treasure is to keep looking or wandering until within the defined search space until it is found. The robot's wandering when it's out of earshot of any stadium qualifies as unguided searching. This stands in contrast to the robot homing in on the noise from a nearby stadium or to a child finding the hidden egg with the help of a parent saying warmer or colder. Searching non-physical worlds. All the search examples just mentioned share a property so typical or familiar of familiar searches that we tend to overlook it. They're based on physical location. Our robot moved from one physical location to the next, succeeding only by arriving at the physical location of a football stadium. The beachcomber checks one physical location after another, hoping one of these places will be where the desired treasure is hiding. Coins in a coffee can may be moved around freely to facilitate their examination, but the objective is still to physically locate coins that make the effort worthwhile. Even web searches come down to physical location by connecting the searcher to a physical server with the desired content. What would a search that isn't grounded in physical location look like? The answer is that it would take place in the realm of ideas. For example, consider the game of 20 questions, where one player thinks of an object that's to be guessed by the other players. The guessers take turns asking up to 20 questions about the object, with the only permissible answers being yes and no. Notice that, while this game revolves around a chosen physical object, the search is not for the object itself, but for the thought of it, expressed by naming it. Indeed, the same guessing game can be played with non-physical categories, such as occupations, or family names, or songs. We'll soon see that egg hunt searches in non-physical search place, the kind of searches relevant to Darwin's evolutionary mechanism, are where the simple meets the surreal. Searching remains utterly simple, but finding becomes incomprehensibly difficult as the spaces themselves become uncannily large. This raises an important question about the meaning of impossibility, one that we'll need to consider in order to decide whether evolutionary invention is impossible. On the one hand, because the thing searched for, the search target, definitely exists within the search space, it's theoretically possible for a blind search to find this target. But on the other hand, since Darwin's account of invention would have to work in real life, we should reject this account if we find it to be practically impossible. And skipping over the next paragraph, the Kuna search. We have a better feel for physical search spaces than non-physical ones, so our reference will be an egg hunt search in physical space. Because we're ultimately trying to grasp the more extreme improbabilities of non-physical search spaces, evolutionary ones in particular, we should push our physical picture to the very limits of familiarity. We'll use the Earth's surface as a reference search space. Our search target will be just large enough to be seen when we stand over it. I have in mind a certain indentation about the size of a pinhead in the middle of a particular bronze plaque that's fixed to the ground. The significance of this indentation is that it lies precisely in the crosshairs formed by the borders of Colorado, Utah, New Mexico, and Arizona. I'll refer to this indentation as the Kuna target, the term being composed from the first letters of the four states involved. The Kuna target covers a mere one part in 100 billion billion equal-sized parts of the Earth's 510 million square kilometers of surface, making this about the hardest physical search we can mentally picture. And we're talking about four corners and a little thing the size of a pinhead in the middle of a plaque. And, you know, the scale is just... close to being astronomical. Having a sense for how ridiculously hard the Kuna search is will be helpful when we look at much harder searches, evolutionary ones in particular. The best way to refine this sense is to perform the Kuna search virtually, which you can do at the GeoMidpoint website, and he gives you the website. This site enables you to drop up to 2,000 pins to random points all over the globe, after which you can view the pinned locations on Google Maps. By zooming in on the Kuna crosshairs, you'll see how close the closest pin came to hitting the Kuna target. You can't zoom in close enough to see something as small as this target, but that won't matter. The closest pin will be miles away. Pinning down the coverage principle. Since Australia, and I should have, that's my ellipsis. Since Australia covers 1.5% of the Earth, we should expect about 30 of every 2,000 pins to land there, 30 being 1.5% of 2,000. You can do the experiment to check this for yourself. When I did it, 29 pins landed in Australia, which is in line with our expectation. In terms of this pin metaphor, the coverage principle may be stated as follows. If enough pins are dropped randomly over a search space, the fraction of them hitting any target within that space is expected to be equal the fraction of the search space covered by this target. As we've just seen, this accords well with actual observations when the target is large enough to be hit easily. In fact, this principle is so intuitively compelling that we took it to be true in Chapter 7 without putting it to a test. Indeed, at least mathematically, it must be true. So instead of casting it as an empirical claim, we should restate the principle as a probabilistic truth. Because probabilities are themselves fractions, fractions of complete certainty, we can replace the first occurrence of fraction with probability and remove the suggestion that many pins must be dropped. If a pin is dropped randomly over a search space, the probability of it hitting any target within that space is equal to the fraction of the search space covered by this target. Yeah? To apply this to our reference search, recall that the Kuna target covers one part in 100 billion billion equal-sized parts of the Earth's surface, which can be written either as a numerator over denominator or as a decimal fraction, as there. The coverage principle states that this fraction also represents the probability of a randomly dropped pin hitting the Kuna target. So we now have a measurement that we can use. It isn't really necessary for the pins to be dropped randomly in order for the principle to hold. All that matters is that hitting the target isn't systematically favored in any way. In other words, you could have used a grid, but you're not any more likely to hit the target unless you know where to align the grid. The pins must be dropped blindly, which may be quite unlike random dropping. For example, dropping in an orderly grid pattern, though it is no more conducive to success unless you have some kind of clue. The coverage principle: if a pin is dropped blindly over a search space, the probability of it hitting any target within that space is equal to the fraction of the search space covered by this target. Spaces of surreal size. The coverage principle is every bit as valid for searches of non-physical spaces as it is for searches of physical spaces. For example, let's take all possible images that are 300 pixels by 400 pixels in size. This is a surreal space. While it is true that some of these possibilities have been actualized in our physical world, figure 8.2, which I'll show you in a minute, being one example, it's easy to show that the overwhelming majority can't be. Our image space is therefore intrinsically non-physical. There's a 300 by 400 pixel, okay? And you can imagine you can put all kinds of other ones. And, you know, some of them will differ by having a big black dot here. Okay? You can imagine all the different permutations that you can get in 300 by 400 pixels. The number of possible color specifications for a single pixel is therefore calculated as the product of the level possibilities of all three base colors, which comes to more than 16 million colors. That is 256 for red, 256 for blue, 256 for green, which multiplies out to 16,777,216, which is why they call it millions of colors. We can calculate the exact number of images in our space by multiplying those color possibilities across each of the 120,000 pixels. 300 by 400 is 120,000. Taking just the first two pixels, there are 16,000 16 million times 16 million, which amounts to hundreds of trillions. A final number so large, when you do it all the way across, the final number is so large it has to be seen to be believed. My computing software does the full calculations in a fraction of a second, resulting in a book-sized number, one that takes 198 pages to print. For comparison, a single 80-character line of text would suffice to write out the number of atoms in the universe, with the total number of physical events over the universe's history requiring only half a line more. So as large and old as our universe is, it envelops nowhere near enough matter and has expanded nowhere near enough time for each of the possibilities in the search space to have been given a physical representation. By the way, I'll back off a little bit and point out that Dembski's number in this scale takes almost two lines, 150 characters, universal probability bound. So this guy is being a little shorter than Dembski, but he's a little longer than Richard Dawkins, who says the 50 characters, which is about 5/8 of a line, is enough to put you over the probability for anything happening in the real universe. The search space can never be actualized in that way. That is, there aren't enough atoms in the universe and enough events that could happen for us to print anywhere near, you know, 1/1,000,000% of all the pictures that we could have. And yet it has true properties that can be verified by analysis, including the strange combination of incomprehensibility and exact calculability with respect to its size. It is at once real and surreal. Fantastically big numbers. The distinction between numbers that are so big they can't be represented physically, because there aren't enough physical things to match the numbers. And numbers that can be represented physically is important enough for where we're heading that I want to have us to have an easy way to spot the difference. In everyday life, we think of numbers as being big at the point where counting them by ones becomes inconvenient. A chaperone on a school field trip easily counts a few dozen children by keeping a mental tally. But to count hundreds would require more elaborate process. So the dividing line between comfortable numbers and uncomfortable numbers, in this practical everyday sense, lies somewhere in the vicinity of 100. Interestingly, this common understanding of a numerical bigness turns out to be handy when we try to get our heads around numbers that defy physical representation, which we'll call fantastically big numbers. As a rough rule of thumb, when the number of digits needed to write a number itself is a big number, then the number represented by those digits is fantastically big. That is, numbers exceeding about 100 digits in length also exceed the physical representation, or nearly so. For example, the number of pixel colors is big, but not fantastically big, whereas the number of images in our search space is fantastically big. In fact, a much smaller search space would still be fantastically big. The space of tiny 3x5 pixel images, for example, includes this whopping number of possibilities. And I'm not even going to start reading that one. Think fantastically big whenever you see the numbers of similar or greater length, and know that these numbers are beyond physical representation. Searcher versus space. We're now ready to fully describe our impossible search. We can think of any search as a contest between the searcher and the search space, with larger targets making things relatively easier for the searcher. I claim that our image search space is so fantastically big here that we can choose a fantastically big target and still show that the space wins the contest. If this is true, it's an important lesson to carry with us into the next chapter, where we'll consider whether egg hunt searches can conceivably invent things. Figure 8.3 shows one of the many ways to make a fantastically large target for our impossible search. Our trick is to use pixels to represent dot matrix characters, letters, numerals, and symbols. 50 rows of characters with 50 characters per row perfectly fills out our 300x400 pixel image size, turning the image into what looks like a small phone screen packed with characters. Let's call any image that's filled with characters in this way a dot matrix screenshot, just to give it a name. Our search target then will consist of, I'm not showing you the actual figure, all images that depict any dot matrix screenshot. We know that the number of these target images will be at least as large as the number of possible character combinations, which is staggeringly large. We can make it even larger, though, by not requiring each character to be made of black pixels against a white background. By experimenting, I found that characters to be readable if their color levels, red, green, and blue, are in the lower third of the range, 0 to 85, while the levels for the background pixels are in the upper third, 170 to 255. Now, instead of using only two pixel colors, black or white, to build the dot matrix characters, we can use over 1,000,000. So our contest looks like this. The searcher will check as many images from the search space, all possible 300x400 pixel images, as possible, to see if any happen to hit our search target by being a dot matrix screenshot. Exactly how this is done doesn't concern us as long as the process is truly blind, meaning the choice of possibilities to check doesn't in any way benefit from insights that would favor correct guesses. The key point is that no matter what the search looks like, every guess consumes physical resources. Physical things have to be manipulated for a guess to be constructed and tested. And this requires at least a little bit of physical material to be devoted to representing each guess for a little bit of time. No matter how efficient or extensive the things that make and check guesses are, these little bits become huge as the numbers of guesses become huge, and as abundant as physical materials and time are, they are not infinitely abundant. So there comes a point where the search is so demanding that it simply can't be completed no matter how the searcher tries to approach it. In the final analysis, then, the contest boils down to a comparison of A, the number of images that can be physically actualized so they can be checked, which is under 10 to the 100, to B, the number of images that would have had to be actualized in order for a dot matrix screenshot to be among them by chance. We know A can't be fantastically big because we've decided fantastic bigness to mean too big to be actualized. This means that the searcher is in trouble if B is fantastically big. We can estimate B by using the coverage principle along with the common sense rule that it takes about a gazillion tries for one in a gazillion outcome to happen by chance. Gazillion here stands for any specific large number. The number of images the searcher will have to check before we'd expect a dot matrix screenshot to be among them is equal to the size of the space divided by the size of the target. That is, search scale equals space size divided by target size. This puts the frighteningly big 198-page number in the numerator, which means the searcher can only hope we've made the target large enough for the resulting answer not to be fantastically big. Instead of exhausting you with more multiplication, I'll just say that the number in the denominator, the number of possible dot matrix screenshot, is also fantastically big, filling about 160 pages. As huge as that is, though, it's not nearly big enough to do the searcher any good. The answer, the number of images that would have to be actualized, is a 38-page number, which we know is is fantastically big. The blind searcher can't succeed because success would require more images to be checked than any physical process can check. The search space wins this contest decisively. We can use the Takuna search to get a feel for just how hopeless the situation is for the searcher. The principle of reciprocal scale tells us that the expected number of blind pin drops needed to hit the Takuna target is about 100 billion billion, which is written out as a 1 followed by 20 zeros. The number of blind pin drops needed for 4 Takuna hits in a row, for example, would be an 80-digit number, which would fill a line of text without commas. Or it would also be the number of atoms there are in the universe. At 6, you would have the atoms in the number in the universe multiplied by the number of seconds in the universe and be under it. At 38 pages, the whopping number of images that would have to be checked for the searcher to find a single dot matrix screenshot has over 160,000 digits. Dividing this by 20, we find our blind image search would be as difficult as dropping pins blindly until the Takuna target is hit 8,000 times in a row by pure luck. That will never happen. The search space wins. The possibility of physical impossibility. Anyone still rooting for the searcher might seek refuge in two thoughts. First is the hope that when it comes to evolution, the most important searches will prove much more favorable than this example search. In particular, if the actual targets of interest cover a substantially higher proportion of their respective spaces than this one does, perhaps the principle of reciprocal scale won't ultimately be an insurmountable object. The second potential place of refuge is the thought that the word impossible ought to be reserved for situations where the probability of success is exactly zero. Admittedly, this isn't true for our example. Rather, the probability of getting a dot matrix screenshot by chance in one try would be represented as a zero followed by a decimal point followed by a very long run of zeros, filling 37 pages and spilling over to the 38th page before the first non-zero numeral appears. That probability can be increased by allowing more tries, but the whole point is that the tries can only be multiplied within hard physical limits. Even under the most wildly optimistic assumptions, our universe, vast and ancient as it is, can't muster enough repetitions to erase more than about 100 of those zeros. Keep in mind that our interest here is more practical than mathematical. Students of math should, of course, learn the conceptual distinction between infinitesimal fractions and zero. But to decide whether success is possible enough to carry on any real implications is to make a practical distinction. not a conceptual one. Bearing that in mind, it's clear that some search challenges favor the search space over the blind searches so overwhelmingly that they should indeed be regarded as impossible. More precisely, success in these situations should be regarded as a physical impossibility in order to distinguish it from a conceptual impossibility. We're free to tell stories about such long odds being beaten, but now we see very clearly why tales of that kind belong in the fiction section, where we filed the tale of Oracle Soup. Whether Darwin's account of life belongs there too remains undecided for the moment. If the dominoes fall, his theory falls with him. Repetition would be the first to topple, should it prove inadequate for explaining the remarkable coincidences needed for life to be seen to be an accident. And it may. As we have seen now, that domino is rather wobbly. Now, my take, I think Axe noted that the truism that natural selection by itself really can't create anything. All it can do is select between already created things. Axe gives natural selection credit for fiddling. That's really too much credit. All it does is it selects between already created things. The mutations do the fiddling. It still requires random variations to do the actual creating. Now, to do the actual creating, we have to depend on either design or random variations or some combination of these. Anything that requires design requires at least one designer, which is precisely what materialism was trying to avoid. Therefore, the only option left to materialism is random or at least blind variations. The next chapter discusses how much luck can be allowed and notes that some events are highly improbable given all the resources in the universe. His term physically impossible is a felicitous one. The tactic of asking for the odds at which one should give up before discussing the numbers, I think, is an excellent one. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn. Go ahead, Ariel.
I would just quibble a little bit, and I think you have probably the same quibble, although you expressed it differently, that natural selection or chance can't create anything.
Well, chance can. Natural selection can't.
Yeah, well, chance can't, yeah. Yeah, we do have the cases where natural selection has created.
It hasn't really. It has had help from random variations.
Well.
And some things are not beyond the reach of random variations.
That's creating something, isn't it?
Like I say, with help it can create.
Like the nylon story.
Yeah. But see, that's only, two mutations or something like that?
Right.
And so that's within reach. Although apparently for tryptophan production, it's not necessarily within reach. Or maybe we just haven't done that for enough centuries until it finally clicks in.
And the other slight quibble I would make, which is that still, mathematically, no matter how big the numbers are, they're not zero. The improbabilities are not zero.
Yes.
Just the opposite. The chances are.
Mm-hmm.
I think we have to face that fact. And this is, of course, what gives these people who talk about the multiverse.
Right. Well, Eugene Koonin concedes the point right off the bat. The probability of life by his back-of-the-envelope generous calculations is 10 to the minus 2018 or something like that. Or 1018.
Yeah, let's figure out there, 10 to the minus 1,000, too.
Yeah.
I feel more secure myself because of that possibility. Mathematically, it's there. It's terribly unreasonable. I feel more secure in saying, well, which is more probable? How far do you go in this game? And you talk about multiverses, and you have virtually no good evidence for more than one universe.
Well, you mathematically can't, or physically can have no more evidence for a, you know.
Yeah, it depends on how you're going to define the word universe, of
yeah.
course. And so on. So, but and then I wish, you know, he had put more emphasis on the time factor of repetition. And evolution relies heavily on this.
Yes.
Yeah, we know it doesn't happen now, but given us enough time, anything can happen.
Yes, but you see, 20 billion years is, what, 10 to the 25th seconds or 29th seconds or something like that?
As soon as you start calculating it out, it gets very unreasonable.
That's right. A comment back here. I'll pass the mic.
Let's see, the answer to that is no problem at all. Because, as I've heard Hawkins and Dawkins and whoever else, here we are. It happened. So deal with it.
Okay. Jerry Brown wins the lottery. Next week, Jerry Brown wins the lottery in California again. No problem. Deal with it. No.
Realistically, yes, if we've got a mind, that's the way we go. But these people run out of thoughts. I mean, when you get to the point where you say, here we are, it happened, deal with it, then argument's over. The science is settled. What are we doing?
That is a sheer claim that we're right no matter what the evidence is.
And if
well, I mean, there's no attack on that, but then it shouldn't have any persuasive power at that point, I don't think.
Any more than a Christian has persuasive power over saying an invisible God did it all.
That's right.
I'm being facetious,
well, actually, it has
course.
Less persuasive power. Invisible gods could conceivably find targets and work on them. When you say, but it happened and it must have happened by chance, basically, that's a statement of faith.
It is.
And I think you could even say faith in the teeth of evidence.
A lot of this requires an extensive knowledge of mathematics, maybe graduate level or beyond. I'm sure Douglas Axe and the publishers both have run this past some of the world's top mathematicians at some point. Be interesting to get their input. Some of them, if they're secularists, probably they don't want to give their opinion because they're going to be caught in a trap here.
Well, that's true, but Eugene Koonin has conceded the point on the other side.
That's an important concession. I'd like to emphasize what Ariel Roth was saying, and that's that those opposing Douglas Axe can set up their own, let's say, game rules. And one game rule, a starting game rule, is you have to have a probability of zero to fully rule this out, to rule out any intelligence. You have to have zero. And so that's an artificial game rule. And Douglas knows that's the number one argument against him. But he's, I think, gotten the best argument together against that counter-argument that I've ever seen.
Well, his point on Oracle Soup hits that game rule in the face. Is it physically impossible that you cook alphabet soup and the letters float up and they suddenly tell you what you need to do to create a new Oh, I don't know. A new kind of x-ray machine? Could happen. It's not impossible. But nobody in their right mind believes that.
The other out is one that Ariel Roth mentioned. That's the multiverse theory. And what my response to that is, what you're doing, you're using intelligence to create a reality that you can't establish. And you're going way beyond what we find in the universe we're in. So it's a futile pursuit to go to the multiverse route.
The multiverse suffers from two problems. One of them is it's absolutely not testable.
It never will be.
Never will be. And therefore, it is in one of the most important ways unscientific.
It's true.
Scientific is a study of the reproducible. You can't reproduce other universes. You can't even reproduce evidence for other universes. Because there is no evidence. Because that's part of the definition of universe. The second thing, and this is really important, is that once you go that way, you have no a priori way of objecting to anything that happens. If you make them infinite universes, I mean precisely mathematically anything. Even if you make them finite but massively parallel universes, you have no practical way. Well, you know, it happened. And as my suggestion, you know, Jerry Brown wins the lottery twice. Well, in some universe, that's going to happen.
True.
You believe it? Come on, guys. I want to know how much control Jerry Brown has over the lottery, and presumably it could be quite a bit. Or somebody who's trying to influence Jerry Brown. I mean, these are obviously design inferences, and they're inferences that jump out at you. Somebody knew and somebody designed it so that Jerry Brown would win the lottery. And they did it twice. You know, it's just not going to happen. I mean, any one person could win the lottery once, but the same person winning it twice has got to be really rare. And that person being the public figure who is in charge of the government, no. I mean, that's just too much to swallow. And yet what we're being told is that Jerry Brown won the lottery 20 times in a row, and it's just coincidence. In some cases, we're being told he won it 500 times in a row or 5 million times in a row.
So in my simplistic way of lay thinking, the opponents of design, they're pushed to the limit. But they're pushed out of the realm of science into the realm of science fiction.
Yes.
Now, what they would counteract and said, anyone who believes in a spiritual reality with a God that we can never see also is dealing with science fiction. And they would say, I like my science fiction better than yours. But they fail to realize that we have evidences of this spiritual reality. You know, answered prayer and other things. So we move from science into theology.
Yes. Comment here and then one down here. Go ahead.
Yeah, I we hear these arguments for a long time about the improbability of life originating. But these are always calculations based on random processes when we don't know what correlations are actually exist in that process that we're trying to describe.
You're going to sell us on correlative entrainment now?
Well, you know, for example, you know, you talk about this Kuna target. You drop things from space, and you eventually, you know, it takes millions, billions of tries to hit it.
Actually, billions of billions
yeah.
of tries.
Well, that's true. But what if there's a process and related, you know, underlying process that is naturally present that results in the targets hitting it most of the time? For example, if we can think of the sun shooting protons at the Earth. That would be a fairly random process as far as the Earth is concerned. And we ask, well, what's the probability of a given proton hitting that Kuna target? Well, if that Kuna target happens to be at the North Magnetic Pole, it's going to get hit a lot, right? Okay, so that's a correlated process that has an underlying mechanism for directing that is purely natural. We're not thinking about those kind of things in this kind of analysis. If we're going to make an argument like this and we ignore the fact that some things, all you have to do is introduce a physical environment in which things become correlated in the processes that do occur, then this kind of discussion becomes irrelevant because you're just sticking with purely random processes that aren't going to convince anybody.
Well, it's not random. It's unguided. It doesn't matter.
No, you're
you see, the reason I say that is because you're assuming that the Kuna target is at the North Pole.
Yeah.
But in fact, it isn't. And so if you're going to use North Pole arguments, it actually directs it away from the Kuna target.
He randomly chose the Kuna target. He could have chosen the North Magnetic Pole target just as easily, for his example. And then that would be a situation that
well, let me answer that question just a little more directly, because the first point is, you, as I said, you assume the Kuna target is at the North Pole, and you may be wrong.
Yeah, but...
But the second thing is, and this is important, if the Kuna target is at the North Pole, North Magnetic Pole, then you should be able to send protons towards the Earth and watch and see where they go, and most of them should go towards the North Pole. If experimentally that doesn't happen, then you're at a blind search, and the claim that it's the same claim that's made that says that there's stepping stones from enzyme A to enzyme B. It's the exact same thing. And it's one thing to say that there are really stepping stones there, but then if you test it, you should be able to find those stepping stones. And if you can't find them, then it suggests either that they're not there and never were, or else things in the past were different from what they are in the present because of some kind of stepping stones that disappeared. And now we're starting to tell tales about, as Michael Behe put it in another way. He says, there's a creek that runs between my house and the neighbor's house in the back. Okay. One day I find the neighbor on my side, and I say, well, how'd you get here? And he jumped the creek. Well, the creek is 2 feet wide. Yeah, probably so. Creek is 6 feet wide. Creek is 29 feet wide. Are you Bob Beeman? Creek is 500 feet wide. No. Well, actually, there are islands that led to me coming up. Yeah, okay. I don't see any islands. Oh, well, they got washed out after I came here. You see, at a certain point, these stories get just too unbelievable. And his point is this. When people tell you things that are just plain unbelievable, there comes a point at which you should say, well, if you want to say so.
But if they're not going to take into account these kind of things that change the probability space.
No, did you hear what I said? If they change the probabilities, they should still be there. The present is the key to the past, according to this line of reasoning.
Well, sometime in the past, the Kuna target, even where he chose it, was where the magnetic field, magnetic north
pole
was.
Or maybe the Earth's magnetic field rotated to the Kuna target.
Yeah, well, sometime in the past, and that was, during some time in the Earth's history, that was likely the case. And you take a snapshot. And the probability is going to be different for every snapshot.
That is true. But do you understand his point? you are only allowed 10 to the 120th snapshots. After that, you run out of
probabilities. But if you don't understand all the correlations that are all involved in those probabilities, there's no way you're going to be able to say for sure that that's the case.
Okay. What you're arguing is something that says, well, it could have happened, and maybe there were things that helped it out. And what I'm saying is this. If you want to make a case that there are things that helped it out, then you have the obligation to find some of those things, or else you are engaging in a faith-based argument without evidence, which is precisely the argument that they're claiming that we make.
Well, you can think of, what's the probability that a planet's going to form in our universe? Well, if you go back to the few thousandths of a second past the origin of the Big Bang, and you repeat that explosion over and over again, planets are going to form. Because the parameters for the law of gravity are going to be in place, and gravity determines that eventually planets will form.
But what determines the particular gravitational force?
Well, that's outside our realm of being able to investigate. So we don't know. We can't say it's God or not. But we do know that because we understand gravity as it is, that if you go back that far, then we know planets are going to form.
But you're asking a different question. Planets are a different kind of object from pool robots. And you can tell me planets will form, and I'll believe you. But you try to tell me that pool robots will form. No. I'm sorry. You have too hard a sell.
It's just if you can say that planets, which is an incredibly complex process.
No, but planets are not incredibly complex. They are round. That's the only distinguishing factor that you have.
No, you could have. You can form.
In fact, they're not even necessarily round. Our planet, of course, is not quite round.
You're going to get rocky planets that are inhabitable zones around stars.
You don't replicate the DNA.
Okay, what you're failing to understand is that the space of planets is much larger in comparison to the space of possible objects in the solar system than is the space of living things. I just gave you an example, and pool robots aren't even living. If you were to try to tell me that somewhere off in some little distant thing there was a pool robot sitting there waiting to be plugged in, if you were to go to Mars or maybe to one of the planets around Alpha Centauri, okay, and you found something that looked like a pool robot, would you be inclined to say that this is just one of those things that happens, or would you be inclined to say there was some civilization there at one time?
But it doesn't get...
No, I answer the question. Yeah. I don't want to, but I want to answer the question. If you did that, what would you say?
From what
yes
we know.
Yes or no?
From what we know.
Okay, from what we know, say yes or no.
The answer would be that it would unlikely that that happened through some natural process.
From what? What?
By some totally random or natural process.
You would not look at that and say there was once a civilization there. Is that what you're saying? You would not, if you came across a pool robot, you would say that must have just formed from earthquakes, volcanoes, melted steel flowing down. Is that what you're saying?
But you're getting past.
No. I don't answer the question specifically.
Well,
if you found that, what would you say? Yes, it was a robot, or yes, it was. Yes, it was the result of a civilization, or yes, it was the result of
from
natural process.
From a scientific perspective, it would just show that we do not know all the parameter space that resulted in that creation of that thing.
What you would say is then we don't know?
We don't know yet.
What would be your personal guess?
That's not scientific.
What would be your personal guess? I don't care whether it's scientific or not. Just tell me what your personal guess is.
Based upon my experience,
yes.
that's what it would be based on.
What would you say?
From what my experience, when I see robots, they're created.
Okay, then that's the answer.
No.
And you have the burden of proof to show that it didn't happen that way.
You know, it wasn't too long ago we didn't even know for sure there was planets around other stars. Now we know that there's planets that are very structured and complex, very much like our own solar system.
I think I can put this argument to rest.
I'm not trying to argue in a direction other than just saying that if you're going to use these kind of arguments that you presented here, it's not going to be very convincing because there's a lot of stuff that...
why it's not going to be very convincing is because there's some people who really, really don't want to be convinced. That's why.
I'm serious with you, and I mean
that every word that I said. And the reason why is because you told me what you would think with your knowledge.
With my knowledge, my experience.
Now, stop here. What that means is that should be the instinctive answer for everybody. Right? And yet I have seen people on the internet argue till they're blue in the face that no, it could have happened just any old way. Because they know where it's going, and what's happening is they're being intellectually dishonest. You weren't, fortunately.
May I? You see, the problem with this kind of argumentation is that everything is looked in terms of probabilities. And of course, people argue if we have sufficient resources, then even what is not very probable is still possible. And if we have enough time, even what is barely possible is very likely. That kind of thinking is what George Wald promoted first, that time is the miracle worker. The impossible becomes possible, the possible becomes probable, and the probable becomes certain.
Yeah,
that's basically the logic of it.
But if there's underlying correlations there,
that time period shrinks to become more possible. You're missing a much more important fundamental issue, and that is the issue of information. Information is independent of the medium that carries it. It cannot be determined by the medium that carries it. If information was in fact determined by the medium that carries it, that medium would be useless for the purpose of information. Same way, let me illustrate. Suppose you have a bottle of ink. That ink cannot determine what you write with it. It can only determine how you write with it. Do you follow what I'm saying? In other words, the ink does not have the wherewithal in it in any way, shape, or form to determine what is written. In fact, if it did have that power, it would be useless as ink. Imagine you try to write one thing and something else pops up. How would that work? That cannot possibly work. You see, in that sense, all information must, underlying word must, remain independent of the medium that carries it. It cannot be preordained or predetermined by the material that it's written on. And that includes DNA. That being the case, we inexorably come to the conclusion that there is no way to produce information by natural processes.
Well, what about the number pi? Everybody's social security number, the social security number, every person in the United States is in the number pi somewhere.
Every rational number can be used in that manner of thinking. That's beside the point. That's the property of irrational numbers. We use irrational numbers where they're appropriate, and they naturally come out of the environment. They do not themselves determine what you write with them. They can determine where they're appropriate. For example, pi is appropriate as a ratio between circumference and the radius. However, it is not appropriate if you're going to use something else, some other formula. You don't pop pi into every equation, and somehow miraculously you end up with the right answer.
It shows up in many, many equations.
Well, let me ask you again, because, see, this is really important, is that you need to establish where you're going to stop before you start using these kinds of arguments, because there's got to be some place you stop. Let me ask you, if Jerry Brown won the lottery once, would you start looking for a prosecution for a fraud? Maybe. If you won it twice in a row, would you start looking for prosecution for fraud?
What you're describing is an underlying correlation there that it doesn't matter where it comes from. It's just obviously there's something going on that
right.
reduces the probability for him to win. Okay, and that's all I'm arguing. I say there's underlying correlations in natural universe and in the natural processes that do not that change the probabilities different than what was presented here.
Yes, okay, now I want to point out that this is precisely the Nagel type philosophy, and we're going to deal with that later on. But that's saying that the universe itself is significantly enough non-random to produce unbelievably small numbers. Like I say, Eugene Koonin making an estimate over a huge, with a huge simplifying and favorable assumptions, puts the probability at 10 to the 1,018th, which is just not going to happen in our universe unless there's some kind of assistance. And so Nagel would be perfectly clear, perfectly fair to say, well, actually, the universe itself is, well, you don't want to say it's designed or created because that implies a creator, but it's structured in such a way that it produces this stuff on its own. Okay. That those probabilities really aren't important because the universe is made in such a way that it beats the probabilities. To put it in your perspective, the Kuna target is located at the North Pole, North Magnetic Pole. Okay? And that's one way of arguing. But my point is twofold. Okay? Number one, that means that the Kuna target is in a very special place. This universe is very specially constructed. That's number one. Which is not exactly a random universe. And number two, that also means that I would expect that if we watched to see where protons were coming, they would be concentrated at the Kuna target. Or there would be some way of arguing that the Kuna target was there at one point, other than just, but it happened. Because but it happened is exactly the argument that is used to justify things, you know, that really aren't justifiable. And it's used to justify things where people claim there was no collusion, there was no intent, there was no intelligence working on this, when in fact you and I both know that there was. Yes.
I just want to point out, there is no known correlation between the evolution of complex systems and the mutation process that goes on in DNA. You run into a stone wall there. If you're going to design, if you have DNA in an organism and that organism wants to evolve an eye, all these mutations, there's no correlation that's going to tie those mutations together to produce an eye. The correlation argument falls apart there in the process of evolution.
Yeah, let's put it this way. That correlation argument has been explored, and been found to be wanting. This is not just a statement that you can make. It's actually experimentally verifiable.
Those are the kind of arguments that that you have to include. Kind of points you have to include in these arguments, though, because this, otherwise we're just saying the same thing over and over again.
Here's the thing. Douglas Hacks comes from a very unique place, and he has actually published this stuff and got it through what I think is fair to say are publishers who are hostile to where this thing is going. He did the work well enough that he got it into the peer-reviewed literature. And so he's not saying this because he's a partisan. He's saying this because he's a researcher that has done the work. Read the book sometime. I don't know if you have yet or not. I suspect not. What? Okay. Read the book. You're coming. I don't remember you were here last week or the week before. And so you haven't seen the core of the book. So I suggest you look at the argument and realize that this is the guy who published how big a space there is for proteins to sheerly fold up and got it into the standard literature. So this stuff has been done. He has done experiments to say, if you start with protein A, can you get to protein B that does this job? And it doesn't matter how it does it, it's just as long as it does it 5%, you know, or 1/100% or 1/1000% as good as what we have now. And he can tell you that, you know, the crowd noise falls off as you get further away from the stadium. At a certain point, you don't have any crowd noise anymore. That it's swamped by the noise of the wind. And what he's saying is, we've done those experiments. And it's time for people to quit. See, that's the point. Is that what you're doing is you're making the standard special pleading, which anybody can make up, and which anybody can make up without any evidence whatsoever. But the point of it is, if you're having to plead without evidence, then you're taking on the weight of the scientific evidence. That's it. And it's time for us. These are the people who are fighting for their ideology in the teeth of the evidence, not us.
The thing that I find fascinating about this line of argument that you're raising is that if the correlative systems that you envisage are in fact as good as you envisage them, then why do we stop at the probability that there is a God? Why is that all of a sudden not likely? Why is it that everything else is likely but God is not likely? How is it that we can find probabilities for everything else but not for God? Do you see my problem?
If you want
to, about reality is that it has to be inherently self-consistent. And if you start down one path and then arbitrarily decide to swerve off the moment you don't like where it goes, well, okay, then I understand you do not subscribe to that path anymore. So why are you still advertising it?
Well, you know, if you start with naturalism, the probability of God is zero.
That's right.
That's the real point.
We had an interesting discussion online, and I brought it to the sub-school on Bates theorem, and I'm trying to think of what the exact title was. But if you Google Giem and Bates theorem, you'll probably find both the discussion online and the presentation here. And we went through that exact thing, and what's really doing the work is the prior probabilities. And that's why what Douglas Axe has done here is so good, is because he said, look, there's some things that if the prior probability drops below a certain point, we should just ignore it. Because it's not, you can't physically test it that many times. To take your example, okay, how many protons are hitting the Earth's surface? Okay, at a certain point, the number of protons becomes, I mean, at a certain point, the precise pathway that you need becomes so small, so unlikely to hit, that even 10 to the 20th protons or 10 to the 40th protons, I mean, 10 to the 23rd protons, you're talking about a gram of hydrogen. 10 to the 40th, you're talking, what, 10 to the 17th grams, which is, you know, millions of tons of protons hitting us, and they're still not likely to get it. At some point, you need to draw the line and say, I quit. And that's the thing. They don't want to quit, and the reason why is because what's really driving this is the zero probability of God. So there has to be something else, no matter how unlikely. And when you realize that, that's what's really going on. And discussions like this, maybe one of their functions is to clear the air on that subject. That what we're saying is, I will take anything over God.
It's a strange thing that scientists can speculate about all kinds of things. They can speculate about all kinds of universes out there. They can speculate life arose on Earth by other beings bringing garbage here at the Earth. It all gets in the scientific literature, but you can't speculate about God. There's an anti-religious attitude there that is not inducive to finding truth. What if God exists?
Well, Dawkins had no trouble talking about God as long as you understood that God had to be created himself, you know. So,
did he?
Was God created?
Did God have to be created?
Well, that's, you know, he has no trouble talking about a God in terms of that sense, you know, because that's fits within the concept of naturalism. We're, you know,
right.
It's the philosophy behind it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Maybe
that
the philosophy
it.
Of naturalism is falsifiable and can be falsified and has been falsified. Quantum mechanics being the first major shot at that. Or at least the first one that scientists don't have a good answer for.
Yeah, well, they don't have a good answer for it. That's true.
And so here's the thing. At some point, it is reasonable to draw conclusions and act on them. Now, for scientists, you can always, you know, put it off because it'll come later. For people who are living real life, you can't put it off. Every week you're going to have to decide whether you're going to go to church or not. And you're going to decide it partly based on whether there is a God to go to church to or not. So, you know, we don't have infinite time to decide this. And at some point, if God's ahead in the running, you ought to go with him, don't you think?
Josh,
depending on how far ahead he is and so forth, but yeah.
Yeah, we all have to make that decision sometime.
Yeah.
Whether God's in the running or not.
Yeah.
Okay.
And see, you know, there was a point where you were ready to concede that, yeah, in all probability, if I found a pool cleaner in some planet, that I'd say that there probably is a civilization there. Okay. That means that at least for pool cleaners, your evidence against a civilization isn't infinite. Okay. When you have people say, well, life probably arose spontaneously, even though the very best odds, again, with all kinds of favorable assumptions, they're probably not nearly that good. According to one of the senior researchers in this area, is that that probability of life is less than 10 to the 1,018th. That now you're starting to talk about something that is, and in fact, that's what he does, basically. He says, we've got to have more universes because it just couldn't happen here by chance. Just couldn't. And so in the end, your refuge is only infinite universes or God. And the interesting thing is, if there are infinite universes, it raises, how did they come to be? You may find God at the end of that anyway. But if you are absolutely determined that you will not, regardless of what the evidence is, you can do that. It's just that if somebody does that, what they're really saying is, my mind is made up. Don't confuse me with the facts. Well,